Hello, everybody. My name is Austin Brenner. I'm from the University of Michigan, and I'll be talking about Earth's magnetosphere today. So if you're unfamiliar, if you were to plot the magnetosphere, the intrinsic magnetosphere of the planet with no external sources and look at it from pretty far away, what you would see is this configuration here. We call this the dipole field. It's the magnetic field that the Earth generates itself. And when we talk about the magnetosphere, we're talking about this system over here on the right. So this is caused by the interaction of the interplanetary space with the intrinsic dipole over there. And so the region that it carves out, we consider to be the magnetosphere. And what I study is the energy transport within that magnetosphere. But this is a very specific question that I had when I was doing my research, which was, how much of Earth's magnetosphere do we actually sense from our ground magnetometers? So a magnetometer is essentially a measurement of the local magnetic field at a location on the globe. So it has these three components, which you see the north, east, and downward. And on the y-axis, we plot the difference from this dipole configuration, and we see what the change in the magnetic field strength is. So we can measure the geomagnetic activity by looking at these ground magnetometer stations. So just a little bit of background on what we're looking for with these magnetometer stations. This is a view head on where the slice is going through the magnetosphere, and we have two different magnetic fields drawn and two different types of current systems. So the important thing about these current systems is that they affect life on the ground. So when you have a varying magnetic field, which is the small changes in the Earth's dipole field, you can induce currents which then can damage critical infrastructure, things like power lines or pipelines. So the current systems that we care about that are highly localized are known as field-aligned currents, which are things like this J1 current here. Those types of currents occur in the auroral region, so the places where you would see the northern lights, and they're highly localized because they go along the magnetic field lines and hit a specific spot in the ionosphere. And so it's really the coverage, when we're talking about the coverage of our magnetometer network, we're looking at how many spots we could actually sense these very localized fields. So this is a looping video showing one station in particular. This is the trace of the magnetic field, and the time that we're looking at is specifically during this peak. And what we're seeing is that we have a configuration change. So this mapped blue line is the magnetic field that's going directly above that station, and you can see it's changing. It's breaking or going into from an open configuration to a closed configuration, and this type of change results in those aligned currents, exactly what we see. And so this is an example of being in the right place at the right time. So we want to see, for our magnetometer network, are we in the right places for the right time in general? So how we'll do this, we now are looking at a number of stations here. We have a global network of 379 stations. And so this video is showing where all of those stations map to. So the outer boundary, this gray shaded surface on the outside, is the magnetosphere. And so you can see that the coverage changes, both from the daily variation of just the magnetometer stations rotating around the Earth, or around the space, and also from the external changing of the system. So you can see both things are going to play a role. We'll have the intrinsic rotation aspect and also the external driving. So in order to better quantify this, so that gave you a sense of sort of what the coverage looks like, but we want to actually attribute a number to this. So what we'll do is, with our simulation data, we'll take any point that maps to a neighborhood of our magnetometer and count that as a coverage point. So you can see an example here. This is for one station. It maps to a neighborhood around this. All of the green cells here map to a neighborhood within 300 by 300 kilometers of this magnetometer station. So what we're going to do is repeat this for all of the magnetometer stations and get a quantified number of how much percent coverage we have. So we're going to look at obviously the volume, so how much space we're covering, but also these weighted quantities up in the top left. So the first one is the magnetic energy density, and the second is the magnetic disturbance energy density. And those weightings are important because sometimes we're covering a volume, but the actual energy in that volume is small. So we want to look at both numbers. All right, so here we go. We got our stations counting up in the top left. We have our three quantities we're tracking in the top right. And you can see that the system is very dynamic. With this view, I want to emphasize that the camera angle is not changing. So when you see this whole structure moving from the right-hand side to the left-hand side, that's all from the external solar wind pushing the magnetosphere one way or the other. And you can see that the gaps in coverage change with both of those factors that I mentioned before. And so the video is going to loop, but what we see is that, at least for this time interval, we're hitting about 7.5% coverage, both in volume and the disturbance magnetic energy for the whole system. And so we've done it. We've quantified what our coverage is. It seems like it's about 7.5%, and that's relatively small. But it's not the only thing we have. So if we look at the... Oh no. There we go. Oh, sorry. You got it? All right. Sorry. So this is just showing some satellite data. So these are traces of a few different satellites that were in the same, this is over the same time interval that you watched that video. And so you can see that in addition to the magnetometer stations, we also have other sources that we can compare to. And combining these two gives us even more information about where these current systems might be and how they might affect life on the ground. And so with that, I want to make some acknowledgments. All these representations were made with a simulation tool called the Space Weather Modeling Framework, which is something that's been developed over many years at the University of Michigan. And the magnetometer sources came from the SuperMag network, which is a publicly available place where you can get compiled lists of all kinds of magnetometer information. And of course, thank you to the Hyperwall for letting me present this all to you. Thank you.